In the name of the Father, and of the Son,
and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please sit down. We come together this afternoon to say thank you to God and to give thanks for and to celebrate the life of Barbara Singleton. Barbara, who's now gone to be with God, is, I can see by the tremendous number of people here today, someone who was held in high regard by many, many people and has lived a good, full and a great life. And no doubt you will remember today Barbara's vivacity, her family commitment, her service to education, giving so many people such a good start in life, so many things that known only perhaps to Barbara, but also I believe to God. Her commitment to church and faith, her attendance at this church, and her sense of being organised, but also at the same time being very, very gregarious. I'm going to hear more about all of these things and one more part about Barbara's life in our service. But I just want you to hold those things in your minds as we begin this service in this special place where so many people have been before. And in this church, in the sight of God, to commend Barbara to God's eternal keeping, being happy and glad that you have shared a part of her life, that she's shared a part of yours. And so we meet in the resurrection faith that Jesus teaches us, that God holds all souls in life, as the Bible teaches us, and that no precious child of God is ever lost, that God will always take care of Barbara. We hold that resurrection faith in this service. And in this service, we also pray for those who are closest to Barbara, for Tom and all his family, for Rob, Dave, Helen, Emily, Poppy, Maisie, Finley, Francesca, and Natalie, and Barbara's wider family. We remember them in our prayers and ask for God's strength and commitment and compassion for them, especially today, but in the days that is going to follow. We're going to keep a time of quiet just at the very beginning of this service now for you to remember Barbara, for you to think of particular times and places that are special to you, that you may have shared with her, that made Barbara the person she is in your life and in your own ways. Short time of silence before our opening prayers, just to say thank you and just to celebrate Barbara's life. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. And so we meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you all. We have come today to remember before God our sister Barbara, to give thanks for her life, to commend her to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, to commit her body to be cremated, and to comfort one another in our grief. Almighty God, you judge us with infinite mercy and justice, and love everything that you have made. In your mercy, turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life, and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven, through our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So we stand to sing our first hymn. If you've got one of the lovely orders of service, you'll find it on the first page, All Things Bright and Beautiful. If you have a hymn book, it's number 533. 533. Please, you stand.
Thank you.
asked us, ask his forgiveness, for he is gentle and full of compassion. God of mercy, we acknowledge that we are all sinners, and we turn from the wrong that we have thought and said and done, and are mindful of all that we have failed to do. For the sake of Jesus, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and help us to live each day in the light of Christ our Lord. God our Father, forgive you all your sins, and bring you to the eternal joy of his kingdom, where dust and ashes have no dominion. Amen. Merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son, whom you raised from the dead, and strengthen our faith that Barbara and all who have died in the love of Christ now share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Not for me, though I have gone into that gentle night. Grieve, if you will, but not for long, upon my soul's sweet light. I am at peace, my soul's at rest, there is no need for tears. For with your love, I was so blessed, for all those many years. There is no pain, I suffer not. The fear is now all gone. But now these things, out of your thoughts, in your memory, I live on. Remember not my fight for breath, remember my strife. Please do not dwell upon my death, but celebrate my life.
Eternal God and Father, we praise you that you have made people to share light together and to reflect your glory in the world. And as we give you thanks today for Barbara and for all that was seen of your goodness and love in her life, for all that she means to each person here, help us to remember that as we too journey towards death, we can do so in the company of Jesus, who came to share our life, that we might share the life of eternity, and to him be glory with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. So God our Father, we thank you that you have made each of us in your own image, and that you have given us gifts and talents with which to serve you. And we thank you today for Barbara, for all the years shared with her, for all the good seen in her, for all the love received from her. And now give her strength and courage to leave her in your care, confident in your promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Firstly, I'd like to start by thanking you all for coming today to celebrate the life of Barbara and for all of your lovely messages. As you know, my mum was an incredibly special person. Her life began in October 1946, in Preston, where she lived the rest of her life. She was a third child of Harold and Edith, who lived in Ribbleton, and she had two elder brothers, Michael and David. She started school at Greenlands Primary School in Ribbleton, making friends that would last a lifetime, and some of whom even visited her in the last few weeks of her life. She moved on to the newly built Ribbleton Hall for secondary school, and in her third year, she met Joan, who was a new joiner, who she made feel welcome on her very first day. Joan describes the teenage Barbara as kind, caring, and full of fun. a bright, bubbly and clever pupil who was popular with both pupils and staff alike. Joan and Mum became close friends immediately, and their friendship lasted a lifetime. Mum threw herself into everything that school had to offer. She was a strong hockey player, played for the school, and she also had trials for Lancashire. And she participated in all of the school drama productions. In later life, after a glass of wine or two, she was known to launch into a full repertoire. And some of you might just remember her rendition of I'm Looking Over a Four-Leaf Clover or Get Me to the Church in Time. Some of you might also remember how good an organiser my mum was. She was always the first to volunteer for organising a party, a weekend away, or a reunion. And this started at school, during sixth form, when she organised a breakfast group which enabled her to sneak away on school field trips for illicit visits to the local pub. And outside of school, she was active in the local church and was even crowned as the Rose Queen. As a teenager, on a trip to the Isle of Man, she, Joan and others were caught drinking underage. But Mum was more worried about her parents finding out than the telling off that she received from the police. And on another trip, this time to Abersock, she and her friends accidentally burnt down their tent whilst attempting to cook, which resulted in four of them spending four nights in a mini. And I think the tent actually belonged to her brother Michael, which made for a difficult conversation on the way home. After school, Mum went to St. Catherine's in Liverpool to train as a teacher, where she became friends with Heather, Ark, Jane, and Cam. Again, they became lifelong friends, and Heather, who now lives in Australia, visited Mum only a month or so ago. Mum graduated from college in the late 1960s and began teaching at St. Stephen's, where she taught for the next 38 years. But it wasn't all work. In her first summer holiday as a teacher, she set off with her friend Julie on an adventure, taking trains across Europe to Brindisi in Italy, where she got a ferry to Greece. And she spent the next 5 weeks traveling around, sleeping on beaches, on hotel roofs, washing her hair in the sea. And as ever with Mum, she loved having a good time, and I remember hearing all the stories as a young boy. She also enjoyed going out with friends in Preston, and Thursday nights in particular were particularly big. So Mum found Friday mornings hard work, and she devised the idea of whispering Fridays in her classroom. The kids loved it, and it allowed Mum to recover from her hangover. And I think it was on one of those nights out, in the Conqueror, that Mum met Dad, the love of her life. They dated each other for 5 years, and Karen and Sheila, her nieces, who shared a room with her at her parents' house, remember Auntie B patiently playing with them while she sat at her dressing table trying to get ready for dates with Dad. And Mum also played Cupid, introducing many of her friends to their husbands, some of whom I think are in the audience today. Mum was an excellent teacher. My godmother, Jenny, started work as a training nursery nurse in Mum's class in 1971. Jenny saw Mum teach firsthand and remembers her being a wonderful, caring teacher, passionate about her job, strict but fair, and the children loved her. She always seemed to make lessons fun and interesting. She was a great listener, always able to tune into a child's particular problems. Mum married Dad in 1975, and they honeymooned in Paris. They also bought 19 Newton Road in that year, the house in which they lived for the rest of her life. I came along in 1976, with David Foley in 78, and Helen in 1981. And Mum was a wonderful mother. Caring, kind, fun, trusting, loyal, and patient. I remember a very happy childhood, with holidays in Spain, Cumbria with Joan and Paul, Abersock, this time the tent didn't burn down, and lots of trips to France. She was incredibly generous. She always put us first and gave us time whenever we needed it. Throughout the 1980s, she continued to work at St. Stephen's, but she was also a Sunday school teacher at St. Andrew's, and she was elected to be the parent governor of St. Andrew's School. And on one embarrassing occasion, the governors were discussing how to keep the local unions out of the school playing fields. And they were all gazing out of the window at the fields when my brother and I came past loudly on skateboards. I think she pretended that she didn't know us. Mum and Dad had a great social life with a great bunch of friends from the Grasshoppers. And as we children got older, Mum and Dad could increasingly enjoy holiday club weekends away or trips to Twickenham, many of which Mum organised, collecting the money each week from her friends. Her friends also used to give her swan ornaments at every opportunity. A pupil had once given her a pair of porcelain swans on a seesaw as a gift. And after that, her friends took every chance to buy her the most awful swan-related paraphernalia you can possibly imagine. I think she once went on a long drive to an out-of-town charity shop to offload some, because if she tried to ditch them locally, her friends would spot them and buy them back again. Emily was born in 2004, and so Mum became a grandma shortly before she retired. She loved every minute of grandparenting. Poppy, Maisie, Finley, Francesca, and Ossoli followed, and Mum would travel far and wide to spend time with them. Wherever Katie and I were based, she'd find a way to visit. Often, when the kids were small, driving herself down to Rutland after she finished work on a Wednesday, where we were based at the time. She was incredibly patient, playing games for hours and always thinking of things that the kids would love to do. Emily and Bobby remember her playing jewellery shops, where they take Mum's jewellery and then sell it back to her. Baking, going to the theatre to watch musicals, her bubble-making machine, which she always packs in the boot of her car, trips to Lidham for ice cream or fish and chips, or patiently watching them ride their horses. And the list goes on. Mum retired in 2006 when she was 60, and many of you will remember the rather large party at the Hoppers. It wasn't just attended by her friends and work colleagues, but many of our friends too, as Mum was hugely popular with the younger generation. Put simply, she loved people and she could get on with anybody. My friends were always amazed by her ability to open another bottle of wine at 2 a.m. and happily chat through into the late into the night. Retirement was mainly all about grandchildren and friends, but she also managed lots of travel too. Trips to see her children in Cyprus, Germany, Austria, the USA, New Zealand, Mauritius, plus holidays to Spain, Morocco, Italy, Bulgaria, the Canaries, and one of her last trips to Australia to see her college friend Heather. But she also loved quiz nights in the pub with friends, puzzles, going to the theatre, and reading. She was devoted to Dad. She spent 55 happy years with him, 49 of them married. She confided in her niece Karen that she still got excited when she heard his car coming up the drive. They were made for one another, and their love helped them get through the last few years after Mum was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. It was lovely that Mum was able to stay in her home, and she was uncomplaining and dignified despite her condition. And Dad would do anything for her. She was an amazing woman, full of life, full of fun, a great friend, and a wonderful daughter, sister, mother, mother-in-law, aunt, grandma, and most of all, a loving wife.
Hi everybody. Before I start, I do need to deal with the elephant in the room. I do wear reading glasses now, Rob. We're not allowed to make fun of it because it's Mum's funeral. So, when I was thinking about what to say today, I first thought that I'd tell lots of stories about Mum and share my personal memories. But we've all got our own stories and memories of Mum, and I'm just as interested in hearing yours as you are in hearing mine. So rather than share my personal memories with you here, I'd like us all to spend this afternoon at the Bowling Club sharing our stories and memories with each other, in the hope that we fill the room full of mum's energy and spirit. So instead, for now, whilst you maybe sit and think about some of your own personal memories, I'd like to talk about some of the common themes that I'm sure will run through all these stories. And it's my hope that you'll recognise some of the things I'm going to talk about. So, who was Mum? Mum was nice. She was just really nice. It might sound like faint praise to call someone nice, but she was just genuinely nice. And I don't think that's faint praise, because what could be better than being remembered for being nice? And that's one of the reasons that you're all here today. You liked and loved Mum because she was nice to you. She was kind to you. Mum's unfailing kindness is something we've heard time and time again in the many messages and cards that we've received. It's a word that comes up over and over again in a file of letters and drawings that the children from St. Stephen's School wrote for Mum when she retired. I'll miss you, Mrs. Singleton, because you were always kind to me. Kindness is the first thing I think of when I think about Mum. She understood that being kind was the most important thing in life, long before there were Primark t-shirts that said, be kind, or internet memes that said, in a world where you can be anything, be kind. Kindness just came naturally to Mum. It's who she was. This kindness and generosity of spirit is why Mum was a friend to everyone she met. The number of people here today from all walks of life is recognition of this. Mum could, and often did, talk to anyone. She had a gift to meet people on their level and make them feel special. She saw the good in everyone. Whether you were a friend for 60 years or a recent acquaintance, a colleague, a school or college friend, one of the Saturday night gang, a nurse, a carer, a neighbour, a member of the community, or a friend of one of us kids, whatever your age and whatever capacity you knew Mum, no one ever had a bad word to say about her, or indeed her about you. There's a saying that goes something like, count your wealth in friends and not funds. If that's true, which I believe it is, then Mum was absolutely loaded. It's been clear as well from the incredible amount of messages and cards that we've received from all over the world from people from all walks of life, just how many lives that Mum touched. I don't think Mum had any awareness of this. I'm certain that she had no sense of arrogance about it. It's just who she was. She made people feel special, and that's why people remember her. What an incredible gift to have been such a positive influence in so many lives. It's also clear that if you met Mum for an hour or knew her all your life, you'd probably say the same things about her. She could never be anything other than who she was. She was able to touch so many lives because she was genuinely interested in other people. When Mum asked, how are you? It wasn't a generic greeting. She actually wanted to know, and she would listen if you told her. This is what made Mum special. I'm sure that most of you will also know that family was everything to Mum. She was the heart and soul of our family without ever wanting to be centre stage. She was the organiser in chief, selflessly devoted to all of us, always making sure that everyone's wants and needs were met before hers. She lived for family events and spending time together. I would often see her at get-togethers, just watching and smiling. She found the secret source to life, being able to take genuine happiness from other people's happiness. She took joy from giving, with no expectation of receiving anything in return. As a family, we're incredibly lucky to have had her as our foundation. We all owe her so much. But today, she's rightfully centre stage, surrounded by family, friends and love. There'll be some tears and hopefully lots of laughter, but the most important thing is that we're all here together, just the way that she would want it. Mum was also incredibly warm, welcoming and generous, and would give her last penny to help someone. But the greatest gift she gave us was to teach us how to be good people by the examples she set throughout her life. So I want to say thank you, Mum. Thank you for everything you taught us without ever feeling like we were being taught. Thank you for teaching us how to love, how to have fun and enjoy life, how to be a friend, how to be a parent, for teaching us kindness and compassion, for encouraging us to follow our dreams, for caring for us and for always being there, and for teaching us that a house full of friends and family is a happy house. Thank you also for teaching us how to stay up way too late and overindulge. I don't believe that it's an exaggeration to say that I owe everything good in my life to my mum. I can trace it all back to going away travelling, and I can trace the roots of that wanderlust back to sitting on the lounge carpet as a child, watching episodes of Wicker's World, and hearing stories of mum's backpacking across Europe and sleeping on the beaches of Greece. When I decided I wanted to travel, mum supported me, and this was another example of mum's selflessness. I knew she'd worry about me and miss me, and that I probably wouldn't keep in touch as often as I should. But she always supported me and encouraged me to follow my dreams, because my happiness was her happiness. This ability that mum had to find joy in the happiness of her friends and family is another thing that made her so special and should be an inspiration to us all. Can't talk about mum without talking about dad. Married for the best part of 50 years, best friends, partners in life. So many wonderful memories and a living example every day to their children on how to be a partner and a parent. The traditional marriage vows read, in part, for better for worse, for richer for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, till death us do part. Dad, you've more than kept those vows. You've lived them. We're incredibly proud of you. You've shown great strength, quiet dignity, unconditional love, tenderness, protection, resilience, and most of all, you still make mum laugh every day. You've been a living example to us all of a devoted partner. Thank you for all that you've done and all that you've taught us through your example. On behalf of Dad and our whole family, I wanted to say a couple of other thank yous. Claire, we simply couldn't have done this without you. You've gone above and beyond in the way that you've cared for mum and supported dad. We'll never forget this. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts. To all the other carers who provided personal care for mum with respect and kindness, we thank you. To the district nurses who were unwavering in their support to dad and for the humanity with which they treated mum, we thank you. And to the countless friends and family who've offered care, love and support to mum and dad, we are eternally grateful. Thank you. Over the last few years and this week, people have commented and offered us praise on how we cared for mum, and we're very grateful for those comments and kindness. But I've often felt uncomfortable with such praise, as it suggests an element of choice. Caring for mum was never a choice, but nor was it an obligation. It's what she taught us to do. It's what she would have done. She prepared us for the task by setting an example in the way that she lived her life and the way she cared for us. She showed us how to love and care unconditionally. In challenging times, I would ask myself, what would mum do? The answer was always obvious. And I think this is a question we should continue to ask ourselves as we move forward as life goes on. What would mum do? What would grandma do? What would Bob do? Whatever the situation is, the answer to these questions will inspire us to be thoughtful, loving, generous, selfless, warm, welcoming and kind, all with a sprinkling of fun and a cheeky grin. So mum was selfless, right to the end. She just kept giving and giving. Even in the final weeks of her life, she was still bringing the family together and bringing us closer. In the days before mum passed away, we spent a lot of time at her bedside, holding hands, talking to her, and comforting her. And I realised at one point, just before mum passed, that I wasn't holding her hand, she was holding mine. I wasn't comforting her, she was comforting me. And in my moments of despair, I felt her wrap her arms around me, and I felt so loved and cared for. And I knew that everything was going to be okay, because she'd always be with us. This was mum's final and greatest gift. Now, illness stole a lot from mum, but one thing that it couldn't take was her smile. We smiled and laughed until the end. All mum's visitors would talk about it. She made them smile and she'd smile back. Many of the cards we've received mention Mum's lovely smile. It's what I see when I close my eyes and think about Mum. And in that spirit, I'd like to finish with a poem. Smiling is infectious, you catch it like the flu. When someone smiled at me today, I started smiling too. I passed around the corner and someone saw me grin. When he smiled, I realised I passed it on to him. I thought about that smile and realised its worth. A single smile, just like Mum's, could travel around the earth. So if you feel a smile begin, don't leave it undetected, but start an epidemic quick and get the world infected.
Thank you so much, Robert Davis. It was wonderful. You did. Thank you very much. Really done your most proud of. Stand now to sing our next hymn, Love Divine, or Love Let Us Love.
A time to be born and a time to die.
a time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to cast away, a time to rend, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace.
To love people and to be able to get on with them, to see the good in people. As Robert Dave has given us such a wonderful picture of Barbara, what better reflection of what God wants for us in our lives could we ask for, or could there be? So as you celebrate Barbara today, remember that reflection of God's love, which I know brought light into the lives of many people, and especially to her close family. And as you remember the things that we've heard about Barbara, that maybe she was very patient with people, the way she was so kind and so loving and trusting, well organised, full of fun, mixing easily socially, making friends and talking to people wherever she went, being the centre of her family as a mother, a wife, grandmother, and enjoying those times spent with her family, running the whole household and finances, a sense of humour described as cheeky, a life and soul of social gatherings, sometimes in contrast to being organised and being gregarious and gracious at the same time, well travelled and enjoying a good, long and well-filled retirement. As you hold on to all of those times that Barbara has been part of your life, and know that you're a better person for having known Barbara, remember that description of our blessings. Someone who is able to love, someone who is able to see the good in people. Because really, in a way, that's all God wants for us in our life. He wants us to live life to the full. He's created us as his precious children, and like all parents, wants to see the child flourish. And there are different times, and there are different seasons in life. And there's also, for those of us who share the faith that Jesus brought, different episodes, different times, different seasons in what God promises to us. So going back, the first one was Jesus' life on earth. I believe Jesus came to earth to just simply show us God's love and how strong and how wonderful and life-transforming it can be. By his actions, by his teachings, by his words, by his relationships, and ultimately by giving himself on the cross and rising from the dead on Easter Day. Jesus, I believe, is showing us just how strong, just how rich, and just how undefeatable is God's love for us. So as you remember those loving times with Barbara, just remember that there's nothing at all stronger than that love. That love is the strongest thing in our lives. And so in Barbara's life, we just see and saw so many aspects of that great love. And as we think of that, the power and the undefeatable nature of that love and how it infused and filled Barbara's whole life, I believe there's much to give thanks for today. And Alzheimer's, described as the cruelest disease, how Baba and her family coped with that, just from what they've shown me and told me, I think is a true example of the power of that love. You know, Dave felt that love holding his mum's hand. So even in those, what could be the darkest of times, there is that light of God's love. Another season of letting go is very hard, and it's very difficult, and bereavement is possibly the most one of the most difficult times, the most stressful and confusing and painful things that you'll ever have to go through. But I believe in it, we have that promise of the power of God's love, that he holds us in his hand and he'll never let us go. And when all of time comes for all of us, as it will, that our body, in one way or another, becomes of no more use to us, I believe that God just holds his precious creation in his hand. And if you think about it, just letting go is the most natural thing in the world. Just at this time, lots of leaves are falling from trees, aren't they? And those leaves have to fall, because if they didn't, the tree would die. And it's part of that cycle of nature, those leaves falling, just at the end of the natural cycle. And so it is with us. If we let ourselves, we can fall into the loving, eternal, comforting arms of God. We find it difficult because we live in a physical world and we're used to dealing with physical objects, including our own bodies. And when we hold on to physical things, our hands are clenched. That's because we're holding something. And letting go is very, very difficult. And if we do let go, there can be a sense of emptiness, there can be a sense of vulnerability. Without letting go, we can't receive what God has to give to us. If your hands are clenched, you can't receive anything. You have to let go and open your hands and accept some of that uncertainty and vulnerability. But along with it, I believe, is what God wants to give us, that blessing of life. So as you go through that process of letting go, Barbara, yes, it is difficult, but I believe in letting go of the physical parts of Barbara's life, you'll receive more of the blessings that she gave to you. And so what's it like? Well, nobody knows. Nobody knows at all what it's going to be like, but we have that promise of God that he will never let go of us and will always be there for us. So it's going to be all right. That's all we can say. It'll be good. It'll be the best thing that you can ever imagine. Somewhere in the Bible, Jesus tells his disciples that he's going ahead of them to prepare a place for them. And that in time, they will be in that place, prepared exactly for him. So imagine a room or a house prepared exactly for Barbara. All the fun, all the life, all the family life, the family times, all those relationships that you've been thinking about, and you'll be thinking about all day, I'm sure. Imagine a room shaped just like that, better even than we can imagine. And that's a picture of God's love for Barbara. So as you mourn, as you laugh, as you cry, as you come together to celebrate this extraordinary, wonderful life that's been lived, and commend Barbara into God's hands, remember that physical, that earthly life that Barbara has lived so well was only the beginning, only the start of Barbara's eternal life with God, which carries on safe and alive in God's loving arms in heaven. Amen. So we're going to have a time of prayer. After each section of prayer, to the words of the Lord, in your mercy, if you please reply, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of mercy and Lord of all life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. And as we give you thanks for Barbara today, and for all the grace and mercy that she received from you, for all that was good in her life, and for all those memories that are treasured here today, we give you thanks in our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, amen.
You are God.
Lord, you promised eternal life to all those who believe. Remember for good this your servant, Barbara. Bring all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And as we remember all those good things about Barbara, her patience, her kindness, her ability to love, her ability to trust, her organisation, a sense of fun, her enjoyment of society, company of people, her ability to make friends, being the centre of the family, enjoying that good retirement and long, happy marriage with Tom. We give you thanks and praise for all of these things. Help us to take those with us, to celebrate them, and to give you thanks for Barbara. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in mercy upon all who mourn. Give them patient faith in times of darkness and strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. And so in moments of quiet, we just pray for those who are closest to Barbara, for Tom, for Rob and Katie, for Dave and Erin, for Helen and Chris, for Emily, Poppy, Maisie, Finley, Francesca, Ottilie, Catherine, Alice, Karen and Sheila, and remember Michael and David, and all who have been part of Barbara's life. We pray for comfort and for strength for them today, and that they may know for themselves your promise of resurrection and eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, you are tender towards all your children, and your mercy is over all your works. Heal memories of hurt or failure. Give us wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to turn to Christ and to follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of mercy, entrusting into your hands all that you have made, and rejoicing in our communion with all your faithful people, we make these our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Saviour, who taught us to pray. And so, together, we pray with confidence in the words our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
When it became clear that
Barb's life would slowly unravel due to dementia. She didn't need to ask for help. Her diagnosis was enough. There was never a question. I was going to help care for her. During those years, she and I sat together for countless hours, looking at the paper, going through photo albums, doing jigsaws, and later pretending to do them. Anything to help her through those difficult days when her anxieties became all-consuming and she was all too aware that the ground under her feet was crumbling. We held hands, we walked, we sat, we listened to music, we pored over countless photo albums, and then we did it all again. As I watched progress slowly unravel, my memories of her began to fade. With each new daily challenge, a little piece of her fell away, taking a bit of me with her. Barb's illness became all-consuming, not just in terms of the physical demands of being a carer, it took over my thoughts as well. I lived, dreamed, and breathed dementia. Countless hours were spent reading, researching, listening to other people's stories of how dementia impacted their lives. I'd reread all of the articles and websites I'd already read 100 times over, desperate for a timeline and prediction of the future. In between all of this, I watched and I listened to Barbara, even when language became lost to her. Still, through all of this, she never lost her smile. She continued to laugh and to cry, and that's how I knew she was still there, obscured by clouds, but not erased. Once she departed this life, it was as if this big shadow of a monster called dementia dissolved, a curtain dropped, and finally I am able to see past that shadow. I finally can reclaim my memories of the beautiful person that dementia worked so hard to erase. Memories I thought would be lost forever. Finally, instead of the image of her being bound in a wheelchair, unable to control her own limbs, I can see her with us when she was well. I can see her joining us on family walks. I can see her going out for a brew and cake, diligently working out anagram clues at the Conti Pub Quiz, playing Peebo with Maisie when she was a baby, holding Finn when he was born. I'm able to remember Christmas dinners and the two of us sharing a cheeky bottle of Sheridan's. I can remember the many times she wore her sunglasses inside, confused as to why she couldn't see. I can see her at my and Dave's wedding, reciting 2 little dicky birds to the children, using full hand gestures, completely unaware that she was also giving everyone else in the room the middle finger. But best of all, I can see her smile, the one that every person sitting in this room has experienced and remembers too. A smile that let you know that you were seen and recognized by her, and that you were special and loved. Despite everything, despite all of the things that dementia stripped away from Barb and from us as a family, it gave us something too. It made us slow right down. It helped us to see that a smile can replace 100 words. It allowed us to experience the incredible power and love that comes from simply holding a hand. Above all, it taught us how to just be. Barb is more than a friend, a mom, a mother-in-law, a grandmother, a wife, a sister, an auntie, a cousin, a sister-in-law, a teacher. She is a beautiful, loving soul who saw nothing but the good in each and every one of us. Although she has departed this physical world,
right now in this room. And no doubt she's smiling and laughing, most likely with a pint of ale or a glass of wine in her hand. So, cheers to you, Barb. Thank you for everything.
Thank you very much, Harry. Thank you. Well done. Our final hymn in the service book went out to number 652 in the hymn books. Guide me over our great Redeemer, pilgrim through this barren land. Entered into glory, confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we entrust Barbara to your mercy in the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you now and forever. Amen. Barbara, go forth upon your journey from this world in the name of God the Father Almighty, who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ, who suffered death for you, in the name of the Holy Spirit, who strengthens you, and in communion with the blessed saints, aided by angels and archangels, and all the armies of the heavenly host, may your portion this day be in peace, and your dwelling in the heavenly Jerusalem. Amen. Bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord raise his countenance upon you and give you peace. May rest eternal grant unto you.
let light perpetual ever shine upon you. Amen. So now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and upon all you whom you hold in your heart, this day and forevermore. Amen.
Facebook mention